So let's kick things off today with a look at an interesting investigation that we've done. It was a joint investigation between Lookout and EFF. And it pretty much spanned for over 9 months. So we'll dive into that. My name is Michael Flossman. I'm the head of threat intelligence at Lookout. So just a super quick overview of what our company does. We're a mobile security company, and specifically the threat intelligence team spends a lot of time looking at actors like this. So we track where their tools are being deployed, which regions of the world, who they're targeting, and what their capabilities are. And I'm joined by my co-speaker, Eva Galperin. I'll let you introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Eva Galperin. I am under-caffeinated. And I'm the director of cybersecurity at the Electronic Frontier Foundation. We're a digital civil liberties organization. Our job is to make sure that when you go online, your rights come with you. And we're going to talk a little bit about a threat actor that we spent about 9 months studying last year, called Dark Caracal. Let's go ahead and start with some background. This is a caracal, in case you are not already aware. It is a wild cat found native to Lebanon, so you can find it in the Middle East. This will be important later, but really, this is because we love cats. Speaking of cats, I'm going to talk a little bit about, seriously, this is a much more confusing microphone than I had originally thought. So speaking of cats, we're going to talk a little bit about this cat. So this is a mannel, or rather, this is a cartoon mannel. And the mannel is a cat which is native to the steppes of Kazakhstan. Pay close attention, because this will be important now. And in 2015 or so, you have to go back in time. One moment, I have to make the back in time noise. So back in time, back in 2015, EFF took on a case having to do with an online newspaper called Respublika. And Respublika was essentially the only independent newspaper left in Kazakhstan. And the way that you remain an independent newspaper in Kazakhstan, which is on a scale of 1 to authoritarian, extremely authoritarian, is to get the hell out of Kazakhstan. So the editors of the paper no longer lived in Kazakhstan, and their web server was located in New York, which is why they needed American attorneys. They were being sued by the government of Kazakhstan because they were reporting on a cache of emails which had been put up under the name KazaWord, which showed a bunch of emails coming between the government of Kazakhstan and a company called Arcanum Intelligence, having to do with their plans to spy on a Kazakh dissident. So no sooner did they start reporting on these emails than the government of Kazakhstan sued them and said, you are the hackers. And therefore you must stop, you must cease and desist, you must put down these, you must take down these stolen emails. So EFF was representing them, and no sooner did we start representing them than they started receiving some very strange emails. Could it be phishing? Yes, of course it's phishing. So they get all these strange phishing emails, and the phishing emails end up in my mailbox because I'm the person who looks at strange phishing emails at EFF. We do a little bit of analysis, and we come to the conclusion that even though certainly all of the data in the emails appears to point to Arcanum Intelligence, we think that maybe it might be these guys. So APIN is a was a company based out of India that provided sort of systems administration and security training services that was also involved in a whole lot of sort of hacking for hire and cybercrime. What we discovered further down the line was that No, it's not these guys. But we are still pretty sure that it was the government of Kazakhstan. So let's go ahead and start with the mobile components of this particular campaign. Because when we did our report on when we did our report on Operation Mental, one of the things that we noted was that there was evidence of a mobile implant. So we're like, there's an Android implant, it's out there somewhere, but we can't find it because we don't have the telemetry. And so one day, Lookout calls us up and they say, hey, we found the Android implant. Want to come take a look at it? And we said, sure.
Cool. Yeah, so from what you can probably guess based on what Ava just said, the story that the EFF released back in 2016 was really interesting to us at Lookout. You know, we're dealing with a nation state actor that are involved in targeted attacks. And at the time, there was evidence of a mobile component, but no one had actually found it yet. So we did some digging, and as you can tell, based on the fact that we're here, we were able to actually uncover that sample in our data set. Probably just to give you a bit of backstory around the name, if you're wondering why we called it Palace, in keeping with the whole feline naming scheme, Palace was shortened from Palace's cat, which is another name for that furry creature you saw on a previous slide, the Manul. So in case you're wondering, that's why it's called Palace. And we basically discovered this family in a number of Trojanized applications. It was a pretty interesting set of categories that these applications fell into. So we had things like Trojanized secure messaging applications, such as Threema, Signal, WhatsApp, plus Messenger. And then also privacy and connectivity applications that users can install on their phones for privacy reasons. So for example, using Orbot to use Tor on your device, and Siphon is a VPN application. We also found Palace in a number of miscellaneous applications, so Flash Player, that's still really effective. For some reason, people are socially engineered into installing this. You know, as you can probably tell if you're in the security industry for the last 10 to 15 years, and it's still getting attackers' mileage. And one of the things that's worth pointing out here, and that I suppose distinguishes this family from a lot of other surveillanceware that we see, is that the Trojanized applications were still fully functional. So other families, sometimes when you install them, you know, they'll pretend to have an error and essentially uninstall themselves while running in the background. But what we saw with Palace is that a user could still interact with the legitimate functionality of, say, Threema. They could message their friends and think that they were using a secure application when in actual fact there was something going on in the background stealing their personal information. So if you're unfortunate enough to have Palace on your device, what's the damage? What are you, what's the risk to your personal information? Basically, it's not looking good for you. So this particular malware family has a lot of the capabilities that are kind of standard in, and that we expect to see in surveillanceware tools. So Palace can, you know, track the location of a device and the user and see where they go. Take photos with the front or the back camera, and then perform other functionality that you'd expect to see, such as recording audio that can be remotely triggered by an attacker. So they can instruct your phone to record audio, for example, if you're in a meeting, but then also record, say, calls that you're making to various parties. And then in addition to that, retrieve text messages, retrieve device metadata, so information about what sort of make and model your device is, your phone number, send SMSs to attacker specified numbers, and then also retrieve decryption keys from certain messaging applications. And one of the probably less interesting capabilities that you might gloss over here is the ability to scan and retrieve nearby Wi-Fi access points. And as trivial as that capability seems, we'll have a look at just how important that is when it comes to attribution in this particular investigation. So how is Palace being delivered to potential targets? Now, during this investigation, we found that a lot of probably the favored attack vector was definitely via social engineering. And specifically, we found evidence of it being delivered via WhatsApp messages that when sent out to high-value assets or targets of interest, it would direct them to a watering hole server that was essentially a fake app store designed by the attackers behind this, and that was hosting the various applications that were Trojanized with this particular Android malware family. So then alongside this, we also had, we identified several Facebook groups, and these were built around socially engineering targets into visiting a phishing server. So if the adversaries behind this weren't able to compromise your phone, they'd go after your credentials for various services. And then also in conjunction with this, it would direct you to the watering hole. So very opportunistic sort of behavior from these attackers, and trying to compromise all your accounts as well as your mobile device. And then interestingly, aside to these two attack vectors, there's evidence that physical access plays some part. So that is the attackers try to physically acquire your device and install malware without your knowledge. And the main C2 server behind this is adobe.net, and we'll get into that in just a little bit. So first off, some examples around both the phishing content and the physical access. So on the left, we can see just a snippet of a conversation sent by an attacker to a potential target. And there's a lot more context around this that we haven't included. But what we can see is that it's basically directing a target to the watering hole server to install a super secure version of a messaging application, and a user's going to have a bad time if they follow that. And then on the right-hand side, there's evidence of physical access. So this is one of the SMSs that we identified being first taken from a compromised device. And what's interesting about it is that it reads along the lines of a victim just got their device back, and you know, they're messaging a friend to say, hey, this is my new number. So it's pretty clear that it's their device was out of their control at pretty recently. And then following that point, malware was installed. So we've got reason to believe that physical access was likely involved in that case and potentially others as well. Taking a look at the watering hole server, so the fake app store, you can see it looks pretty shady. These are, you know, you can see the various applications here that are Trojanized with Palace. And then down the bottom, there's a nice little note saying quality is better, better than the original. So highly detailed. I guess it definitely does depend on how you define quality. So yeah. So one thing you might have noticed, there are no exploits that we're talking about here. This is all just the attacker is basically relying on social engineering. And despite a lack of exploit sophistication, in fact, none at all, they were still really successful in what they did here. And we'll see that when we take a closer look at some of the exfiltrated content. But looking at the actual underlying code of Palace, you know, this particular family and the capabilities in it are really pretty easy for anyone to implement. Just like a lot of other developers in legitimate companies, these guys were probably under pressures to actually create this tooling and to push it out. So what we saw them doing a lot of was actually copying and pasting from Stack Overflow, from other resources like GitHub. For the developers in the room, I'm pretty sure this is pretty standard practice, not just for the white hats like us, but also black hats doing the exact same thing. So the way they did their C2 obfuscation, that was pulled from Stack Overflow, the exfiltration implementation in the client and the server, and they really only made minor modifications to publicly available code. So the barrier to entry in this space is definitely being reduced. We're seeing a lot of lower sophistication actors break into this area, and as a result, there's a definite increase in actors having a capability in the mobile space that's focused around surveillanceware and gathering sensitive personal information. And throughout this investigation and this talk, really, we'll see that you don't really need to be sophisticated in order to be effective. More often than not, what you do need is pretty much a carefully crafted SMS. And believe it or not, that's kind of usually all it takes to convince people to install something. We've seen this in a lot of scenarios. So this isn't like some standalone case. We saw it with ViperRat, which is another malware family that was being used in targeted attacks against the Israeli Defense Force. And we reported on this way back in 2017, but this act has evolved since then. So in the past, they've relied on third-party stores, so having their targets allow installs from third-party sources, but they've now shifted to actually sneaking their tooling into the Google Play Store and combining that with phishing attacks via Facebook as well. We're starting to see this quite often. And also this week, we released a blog on a targeted attack utilizing a very similar technique happening right next door in attacks in Palestine. And that one's called Desert Scorpion. Same sort of attack, vectors, same sort of capabilities, and a lack of exploits as well. Another family, XRAT. So for those of you following activist movements in Hong Kong, way back in 2014, there were pro-democracy activists engaged in or protesting around China's involvement in the democratic elections. And the main organizers of that received messages like this to basically install malware, very similar to what we saw in the case of ViperRat as well as Palace. And it's not only the state-sponsored actors that are doing this. So cyber criminals are also getting a lot of mileage out of this. So the banking Trojan, known as Marcher or Banker Marstealer, this is their standard MO. This is pretty much how they entice people into actually installing their malicious apps. And you can see that a fair amount of people are actually clicking through on these things. So it is highly effective, similar to what we see in the desktop space. Like phishing is always going to play a role when humans are the weakest link, despite the security controls we might put in place. So what about the premium tooling side of things? Now, it was interesting during this investigation to actually identify a sample of FinFisher on one of the command and control servers. Now, FinFisher used to be owned by Gamma Group, and at one point they were compromised by Phineas Fisher, who released a lot of their customer records, a lot of the information about the tooling that they had published or that they had sold to customers. And what was interesting in looking at this specific sample is that it wasn't on any publicly available virus repositories, and it also wasn't listed in that dump of information. So this customer, we're assuming, was likely using this tooling potentially to demo it, or they might have had a short-term license for it, but there was no references publicly to who they were in that leaked information. Interesting to note, it did make use of the Exynos exploit, and it contained 3 mobile endpoints with the +78 calling code, and analysis of that showed that it really lined up with the whole Operation Manil Kazakhstan targeting that Eva talked about earlier. So one of the things that we're seeing quite a lot of is actors are really covering their bases. They're not relying on a single platform. They're shifting to include mobile if they have a desktop capability, and they're essentially ensuring that they have some sort of tooling to throw at their targets no matter what sort of environment they're operating in. So for Dark Caracal, not only were they deploying a mobile capability, but they also had a desktop component as well.
So let's talk a little bit about the desktop component. So Unlike the mobile component, the desktop component was extremely sophisticated. Surprise, surprise. It used chained zero-day exploits, pivoting access off of compromised SCADA systems, and used the blockchain for exfiltration. It was amazing. No, it was phishing. It's always phishing. It's always the dumbest possible thing. I think that the theme that we're going to keep coming back to over and over again with this talk is that actors do not have to be sophisticated to be effective. So let's take a look at the sort of infected documents that were being sent around. Let's look at the lures. These were documents that were being sent over email. They were usually Word, Excel, or PDF. They were taking advantage of macros. In fact, if there's anybody here who is a systems administrator, just turn off macros. Turn off macros, you will make my life so much easier. We found an infected CHM file running PowerShell, so that was weird. But for the most part, it's a whole lot of the usual stuff. And you can see the PowerShell right here. Again, extremely exciting. We found a really common rat called Bandook, which was also observed as part of Operation Manon, but the version of Bandook that we're seeing here is a new variant used by Dark Caracal. Bandook is the Hindi word for gun, and we have been told the sort of Lebanese/Arabic slang for bastard. But, well, no Lebanese person has corrected me so far, so I'm rolling with it. It is modular. It only works on Windows. It's available for sale online, but the versions that we found appear to be a private copy. This is not consistent with the version that we found online. It's heavily obfuscated, and it was found in Trojanized copies of a drawing program and a censorship circumvention program called Siphon, which is very much in fitting with their sort of mobile modus operandi. All the malware-related WIN API strings were encrypted and Base64 encoded. Bandook decrypts them at runtime. Then the second stage is encrypted and stored in a binary resource with an 8-character name. The resource binary is decrypted and injected into the IE Explore EXE process using a technique called process hollowing. And the second stage is packed with a custom version of EPX. We found control panels for multiple campaigns using various bits of malware that included IrisRat, Bandook, and ArchonRat. And we found these servers hosting exfiltrated desktop content. As we will hear later, so much exfiltrated desktop content. Here are some of the things that Bandook does. So your usual capture screens, capture keys, steal USB, get Wi-Fi, all that usual stuff, pop a shell. This is what its sort of plain text communication to the C2 looks like. So as you can see, it's Base64 encoded, and then we just stick a bunch of ampersands on the end, and it looks like this. Then we found a new thing. It's called, well, we decided to call it CrossRap. This is a new malware family. We found version 0.1, which was released in March of 2017. It has limited features. It's written in Java, so it runs anywhere. This looks like sort of their C game of rats, in that they have mobile capability, they have Windows capability, and they're like, okay, so finally you need something that will run anywhere. If the other stuff doesn't work, use this. It has no obfuscation, no packing. It installs itself for persistence. And again, no exploits. You don't need exploits to make this stuff work. They were tremendously successful without a single exploit. Again, it communicates with the C2 over plaintext TCP. It uses a custom protocol. And much like the previous example, this is what that looks like. Everybody, ooh and ah. So let's talk a little bit about the data, because we found a lot of data.
So one of the things that we were pretty excited about when we first looked at the infrastructure was this. And that's pretty much how I felt looking at it as well. So what we can see here is basically server status information from one of the main command and control servers. And what that means is that we can see connections coming in from infected devices, as well as from potential administrators logging into infrastructure and accessing or triggering a certain functionality on infected machines and devices. So one of the cool things about that is that we can actually map out where all these victims are and get an insight into just potentially who they might be targeting. So what we can see here is all that information graphed out, and this is data collected over a 3-month period. You can see there's a distinct band across the Middle East and up into Europe. But then we're also seeing infected devices throughout the United States, Canada, as well as Asia. Now, not only were we able to see where infected devices were coming from, but there were some operational security mistakes made by the attackers that allowed us to actually see all the data that they'd stolen from their targets. So that was publicly available. Anyone that knew the right URL could pull that down and essentially mirror the command and control server. So that was a pretty big mistake for them, but allowed us to see that they'd been operating for quite some time, initially with a focus on Windows malware and exploiting Windows machines, but then also shifting towards having a primary focus in the Android space. So at the time of publishing our report, we found that there was over 80 gigabytes of exfiltrated content. So just let that sink in for a second. These guys aren't using any exploits at all, and they've got a staggering amount of content, especially when you consider this is primarily from mobile devices. And as we'll see in a second, what content makes up a lot of the Android exfil. So when we break down the exfiltrated data, we've got a lot of sensitive personal information, things from SMS messages, authentication accounts. We're seeing call details, recorded calls, recorded environment audio. So a lot of personal stuff, and then a ridiculous amount of images as well. A lot of contact details, Wi-Fi information, pretty much everything you'd want to get from someone's personal mobile device if you're interested in doing some sort of surveillance. And on the desktop side, a lot of screenshots. So the malware had a capability to periodically take screenshots and really build a picture, a comprehensive picture around a victim's daily use of their desktop. So it was actually quite disturbing to see that over an entire day. Way too much information. But then also alongside that, we saw things like Skype logs, call databases, contact details from Skype as well. A lot of personal information, so photos. And then in one case, we also saw the backup of an iPhone. So someone had backed up their iPhone to a compromised desktop, and they'd done so in a way that it wasn't encrypted. So an attacker had complete access to that as well. And then amongst all of this, there was corporate and legal documentation too. So a bit of enterprise data as well. What we can see here are examples of exfiltrated mobile data. So we can see two-factor authentication messages, links to accounts. And then in some cases, we also came across links that were still active for, say, mail deliveries. So these, if you followed these, they'd contain a victim's full name, address, when the delivery is expected to arrive. And this was live at the time, so it was basically real-time monitoring of these targets and a really in-depth look into their lives. So quite disturbing sort of stuff. And it was clear that Dark Caracal, the actors behind this tooling, had really good visibility and insight and were able to monitor and track to a disturbing level the people they were going after. And then on the right-hand side, you know, we can see close to 500,000 text messages, as well as, you know, 250,000 contact details, and then a large amount of Wi-Fi SSID details, which will come into play a bit later. So when we take a look at infrastructure, we initially started with the server at the top, AdobeAir.net. This is their main command and control server for handling exfiltrated content, as well as for providing the administrators or operators behind this with a way to interact with compromised devices and machines. What was interesting when we were looking at this is that we noticed that a few things were kind of curious around the services that were running on that particular box. And they were so unique, in fact, that we're able to build a fingerprint out of that. And you know, humans are creatures of habit. The actor behind this is not different at all. They really like to use the same sort of bulletproof hosting providers and deploy infrastructure in the same IP block. So what we did was we scanned the /24 IP block of this bulletproof hosting provider for any machines that had a similar set of services. And what we can see here below the AdobeAir.net is a number of other boxes that we're able to identify as being related and associated to this threat actor purely because of the services that they ran. And we can see that they kind of have a different function. So secureandroid.info, that's the primary watering hole server that we saw earlier. But then we're also seeing some phishing sites, as well as servers that were responsible more for exfiltrated desktop content. So the fingerprint that we used was based around, as I said, AdobeAir.net. They were running Apache on Windows, which is kind of odd, but then you know, this was combined with certain versions of MariaDB, PHP, as well as PHP MyAdmin and OpenSSL. So it was just curious to see and so unique that we kind of felt they were running some sort of image to deploy this, or they were following a tutorial that was very specific to their use case. And it definitely felt like they didn't have the technical skills to deploy this, say, on Linux, and that they were following a really odd setup that allowed for us to create that fingerprint. So taking a quick look on the Facebook side of things, they had multiple groups that would basically push content like this, and they all started with a nanus followed by an integer. So I think there are about six out there. And they'd have a range of content from directing people to installing those secure messaging applications or Trojanized versions of Palace, but then also directing people to the watering hole servers that I mentioned earlier. And some of it was also politically motivated. So if you followed those links, you'd end up on a phishing site as well. So it's not my first phishing site. We can see they've gone to a lot of lengths to actually make this look legit. At the time, these were identical carbon copies of the real sites. And that was kind of nice to see based on some of the phishing sites we've seen in the past that were easily you could easily pick as being fakes. Searching around the information that we had in VirusTotal also brought up several other phishing sites. So we saw phishing sites for Facebook, Gmail, Twitter.
But that's not all. So let's talk a little bit about the identities that were behind these attacks. So to begin with, we started with the Whois database, and we went looking to see who's behind all this stuff. The infrastructure used by Dark Caracol revealed several different associated personas. So not the actual people, but definitely the names that they kept using again and again. The op13@mail.com address has been sort of key to linking a lot of the structure together. The personas that we were able to identify were Nancy Razouk, Hassan Ward, Hadi Mazay, and Rami Jabour. So you might notice a sort of theme with these. All Arabic. So Nancy Razouk is the name of a journalist who actually lives in Beirut. She exists. She does journalism. We are fairly certain that she has absolutely nothing to do with this campaign. They're just using her name. This is the name that was used with the op13.mail.com. In the whois information, her name was used in the signer content for the Windows malware, and her phone number is in the exfiltrated content, but it is under the name Hassan Ward. Again, this phone number does not belong to anybody in the campaign. It belongs to a person who is really tired of security researchers calling them. So you can see a whole lot about how these various things link together, including Hadi Mazay. Rami Jabour, Op13 registered the domain ArabLiveNews.com using his name. And again, this gives you some idea of who the targeting is, who goes to Arab Live News. The whois information for Rami Jabour, or sorry, for the domain is in close proximity to where we have seen the test devices, which is something that we'll be talking about a little bit later. In fact, now, kind of now. Let's talk about where these guys are. So I've given you sort of a preview. You've got a general idea of where I'm going here. Nobody's going to be terribly surprised. But we spent some time trying to figure out the physical location of these actors, which means playing a little bit of where in the world is Dark Caracal. So we started with the admin console logins. So who's that logging into the admin console? You would think that the people who are behind this campaign, probably the admins, probably logging into the admin console. Where in the world are they? Where in the world are they? Ah, here we go. There's the world. And there they are. Somewhere in Beirut. So we have all of this information that we have taken down from the C2s because these actors left their C2s wide open. And as you may remember, we had the identities of a whole bunch of Wi-Fi access points that they were accessing. And so we threw that all into Multigo, and we got this. You can see two large clusters of information. One is the big thing is the infected devices and all of their collected Wi-Fi networks. But there's also a smaller circle over here. So what do? We enhance, we come closer, and what's this little circle? This circle is a bunch of SSIDs and MAC addresses. And all of the Wi-Fi SSIDs are BLD3F6, which we're fairly certain indicates building 3, floor 6 somewhere. Where is it physically located? Well, as it happens, you get sort of GPS coordinates that go with your SSIDs. And when we mapped the GPS coordinates onto Google Maps, we got the map that you see on the left. So as you can see, there's a street near the National Museum in Beirut. You can see a bunch of blue dots right there. And you can see that they're all located fairly close to one another. But anyone who has ever tried to navigate, say, downtown using their phone in a bit of a hurry in a strange city knows that GPS is not 100% accurate. So then what do? Then we get boots on the ground in Beirut. And we have them whip out phones using Weigel and start looking for this SSID. And that's where things get really interesting, because they're able to pinpoint the exact location of this SSID, which you can see over on the right side of this page, of this slide. And where is it? It is, in fact, the only six-story building for many blocks around, which also makes it a lot easier to find. And it's located near the National Museum in Beirut, and it's conveniently labeled with the name of the people who are inside. I don't know how many of you here read Arabic, but I don't. So who is this? It's the General Directorate of General Security in Lebanon, Beirut. This is sort of their equivalent of the FBI and the CIA, because, you know, why even bother to separate these things? And they are located in this building. There is no one who is not a member of GDGS who is located in this building. This building is surrounded by guards. There is nothing else near it that has six floors. We are pretty sure that whoever it is coming from inside this building. So I'm not going to tell you that these actors are the GDGS, but I will tell you the call is coming from inside the house. So what can we conclude? What is Dark Caracal? It's a long-term offensive cyber campaign with global scope and scale. We found more than 100 gigabytes of stolen data from over 600 mobile devices in 21 countries, thousands of victims. So this is not small change. It targets primarily Android, but also Windows, Linux, and some OS X. What's particularly interesting about this campaign is that we could see that they started with Windows, and we could see them slowly moving to a primarily mobile way of going about this. The threat actor is believed to be administering its tooling out of a facility belonging to the GDGS of Lebanon in Beirut. Again, can't say it's them, definitely can say it's coming from inside the house. What else can we learn? Cyber warfare is getting cheaper. A lot of people at RSA are going to get up on stage and they're going to tell you that cyber warfare and cyber espionage are getting more sophisticated, that your attackers are getting more sophisticated, that everything is becoming more expensive, that everything is becoming fancier. I'm going to make the opposite argument. Attackers are becoming dumber. Their methods are becoming simpler. And it still works. So what we've seen here is an actor that went from premium tooling such as FinFisher and decided to abandon it in favor of rolling their own with a variety of commodity products. And they still managed to pull off a multi-platform cyber espionage campaign. They're primarily using mobile as an attack vector, and they've been able to hide in the noise of misattribution for years. They looked so much like this annoying Indian actor that had been running around doing cybercrime for years that we were unable to distinguish them. Furthermore, we can come to the conclusion that Dark Caracal and Operation Manwul are not the same actors, because otherwise we have to spend a whole bunch of time trying to figure out why the same people are interested in spying on, say, dissidents in Kazakhstan. Otherwise we have to figure out why the government of Beirut is interested in spying on dissidents in Kazakhstan. And that is not an argument that we are making. We believe that this very same infrastructure is being used to spy on dissidents in Kazakhstan and then was later being used by the GDGS for its own purposes. So what does the GDGS have to say? The Major General Abbas Ibrahim, Director General of the GDGS, started out saying, "General Security does not have these types of capabilities. We wish we had these kinds of capabilities." And a little further down, "We wish we had a small part of the capabilities that the report attributes to us." A little bit later, they went ahead and said, "It's definitely not us. No, wait. It might have been us, and if we did do this, then it's totally legal." So it's not really clear what their take is on this. The Wi-Fi SSID was taken down, so if you're looking for building 3, floor 6 in Beirut right now, you are unlikely to find it. If you just happen to be wandering around the National Museum, I'm pretty sure they're calling it something else now. Thank you very much. If you're interested in more information about the Dark Caracal report, I recommend taking a look at these URLs. We have all of our blog posts and our research report, and finally, our research report on Operation Manwul from 2016, which you may want to take a look at, which got all of this started. So thank you very much. Now it's time for questions.
Hi, I have a question or more like a comment on the theory as to why the infrastructure is being reused. Would it be possible that a large for hire defense contractor would be used between the different governments, you know, hired for this job, then later hired for this, and it's just easier for them to use the same infrastructure.
Yes, it's absolutely possible that these are hackers for hire. In fact, we find it likely. Anybody else? We've answered all the questions. Ah, there's more.
Hi there. Hi. Why do you think the attackers had their command and control servers so wide open that you were able to download the data? That just seems silly.
We also thought it seemed very silly. Boy, were we surprised. It is my understanding that we were going to start off writing a very short report. We thought that we had found a little bit of extra infrastructure. We wrote up a report, I think, that was like 5 or 6 pages long. And then just before we were about to hit publish, my colleague, Cooper Quinton, said, hey, last time I took a look at these guys, they left their directories wide open, and I managed to pull down all of their exfiltrated data. How about we try that? And he suggested it to the guys at Lookout, and they said, really? Really? They can't possibly be that stupid. It turns out they were that stupid. And we pulled down all of this data, and then the second version of the report that we ended up writing was over 100 pages long. That is how much data we exfiltrated. It took forever. And even then, we didn't get all of the CNCs, just a couple of them were up.
Just adding to that, it tends to happen quite a lot, surprisingly, where actors just have poor OPSEC and their focus is not on securing their own infrastructure. I'm guessing maybe their focus is software development and they skip those classes on securing infrastructure. As a researcher, I like it, but yeah, it's concerning, that's for sure.
Anyone else? Thank you very much. Thank you.